Hello friends, I am Dr. Vijay Prakash and today I will be telling you about impression making in removable partial dentures. Now if you have a tooth supported situation like a class 3 or a class 4 situation, then impression making is not a problem because the abutment teeth are bearing maximum of forces. So residual ridges, the edentulous ridges doesn't play much role. So we can record the tissues in an anatomic form. So in these type of cases where tooth supported areas are there or tooth supported cases are there like class 3 and class 4 situations, we can use an anatomic regular impression. You can use your alginate impression material or silicone impression material using stock trays, so that is not a problem. But if you have a tooth and tissue supported situation like class 1, class 2, even a class 4 situation wherein you are having more than 6 teeth which are missing, then it becomes a longer span. In those cases, you require a functional impression too. Now, we have to take two types of impression. One is the anatomic type of impression, another one is the functional impression. So that when we are taking both these types of impression, when we want to record the tissues in a functional form as well as anatomic form, that is known as the dual impression. So dual impressions are required in class 1, class 2 and distal extension situations or tooth and tissue supported partial dentures, as I just mentioned to you. Now, so why do we want to record the tissues in a functional form? Now we need to understand that since it is a long span, you can see this is a class 1 situation wherein you have bilateral edentulous posterior region. So there are certain teeth where you have the abutment teeth. Now teeth cannot move as much as your resiliency of the mucosa. Depending on the resiliency of the mucosa, whenever you are making an anatomic impression, that is not going to work in an edentulous region because of the resiliency of the tissues and rebound phenomena of the resilient tissues. So when we are recording the tissues in anatomic form, where teeth are not, there is no movement of the teeth as such, we record the tissues in anatomic form, where we anticipate that there will be mobility or moving of the tissues because of the resiliency of the mucosa, like in the edentulous posterior region which is covered by mucosa. So in those cases we need to record the tissues in a functional form. That is the reason for a dual impression technique. Now, what are the factors which can influence the support of a distal extension partial dentures? I have already explained this in principles of removal partial dentures and even in biomechanics. We'll just run through that very fast. Now, the factor can be the type of soft tissue which are covering the edentulous ridges. If we have well-rounded ridges which are having firm mucosa, you have a better support than in comparison to your loosely bound tissues which are having, say, kind of a hyperplastic tissues. Those will provide a poor support. Type of the alveolar bone constituting the denture bearing area could be another factor, wherein if you're having a cancellous bone, it will give you a poor support in comparison to a cortical bone which is very well supporting the vertical forces, and you have a better support with the cortical bone. Next is design of the partial dentures. Wherever you have a design, like if you have this kind of a situation which is a distal extension situation, if you are only relying on the direct retainers without providing any provision for indirect retainers, the chances that there will be movability of the partial dentures. So you have to provide a kind of indirect retainers which can resist the rotation of the processes by taking the fulcrum arm anterior, so that you have a best mechanical advantage. Another thing is your magnitude of the occlusal forces that can be reduced by reducing the amount of force per unit denture base. That can be reduced by the broad stress distribution that can be helpful by broad coverage of the edentulous area whenever you are making an impression. Secondly, by narrowing the occlusal table by reducing the buccolingual width of the teeth, and thirdly by increasing the efficiency of the occlusal table by providing sluice ways which improves the mastication and chewing efficiency. Next factor can be the amount of tissue which is covering the denture base. As I told you, you have broader and greater the edentulous region, the more dependent you are for the support in this region. So if we have loose hyperplastic tissues, it is better to do a pre-prosthetic surgery in that case and then improve the support rather than sticking with those type of tissues, and then you know you cannot control movement of the partial dentures. Then another thing is nature of the denture bearing areas. As I just told you that you should rely on stressing more areas which are denture bearing, which are stress bearing areas rather than non-stress bearing areas. Like in this case, you have the buccal shelf area, which is a stress bearing area, and the crest of the residual ridge, it should be relieved. And similarly, in the case of mandible, you have the rugae region, the palate region, which is main stress bearing area, and the buccal and lingual slopes. So there you should be concentrating more of the functional forces in comparison to non-stress bearing areas like the mid-palatal region in the maxillary arch. So, and another thing is the fit of the denture base. Your impression has to be accurate, then only you can make a good properly fitting denture base or properly fitting denture. If your denture is moving, then controlling of stress is very difficult, and there will be unnecessary stress on the abutment and the residual ridges. Now, impression making, first, as I told you, your totally tooth supported regions like class 3 and class 4 situation, you go with a stock tray and you can load it with any type of impression material like alginate or your silicone impressions, and you can take an impression. That's not a problem. Another thing is if you are going for distal extension cases, then you have to use a dual arch impression technique, and you have basically two methods of recording dual impression technique. One is the physiological or the functional impression technique. Another one is the selective pressure impression technique. The physiological or functional impression techniques are of three types. One is MacLean and Hindle's method. Another one is the functional relining method. And third one is fluid wax method. Let us see each of these one by one. The functional technique usually records the edentulous region by placing occlusal load on the impression tray during impression making. And if you see a MacLean's or Hindle's physiological method, so MacLean's physiological impression technique was first given by, as the name suggests, by Dr. D.W. MacLean. And according to this technique, the tissues of the residual ridge of distal extension cases are recorded in functional form, and then a second impression is made over this. So first, what you do, you make a custom tray. And in that custom tray, you have the occlusal rim which is made on that. After that, with this custom tray, you will load it with your impression material, like impression paste. So when you have loaded with the impression paste, you'll ask the patient to bite on the occlusal rim. When the patient bites on the occlusal rim, you'll allow the material to set. Once it is set, then you'll take a stock tray, and what you're going to do, you're going to load it with an alginate impression, and over this occlusal rim, you're going to take the alginate impression. So you're recording the edentulous ridges with the functional method and the remaining teeth with the anatomic method with the help of dual impression. The drawback of this technique, however, is you're only applying a finger pressure. And when you're applying a finger pressure, it is not equal to the biting pressure which is applied during the functional impression. And small amount of alginate impression material, if you see here, if you have the small amount of impression material which will act as a buffer between your occlusal rim and this stock tray, and because of this, the it will hinder in transferring the load onto the custom tray and to the edentulous ridge. So actually, you'll not be able to record the tissues in a proper functional form. So seeing these drawbacks, Dr. G.W. Hindle modified this impression technique and used a stock tray by making a hole in the stock tray in the posterior region. And these holes were 18 millimeters of diameter. And the remaining technique was same as the MacLean technique. Here, when he was taking an impression with the stock tray, there through these holes he applied finger pressure directly onto the occlusal rim, so that you record the tissues better in the functional form. The drawbacks of this technique was, in the denture made with this technique, if the clasp assembly is effective, it will allow the denture base to displace the soft tissues in the functional form. And this will lead to basically adverse tissue reaction, because it is displacing the soft tissues in functional form, and it will also lead to greater resorption of the residual ridges. So the technique was like this. And if the clasp assembly is not effective, what it will do, it will maintain the denture base slightly occlusal in a rest position. When the patient is not biting, the entire plastic denture is going to slightly come up in occlusal. And when the patient tries to occlude, tries to bite, the artificial teeth will come in contact first before the natural teeth. And it will be really comfortable, and it will also lead to instability of the processes. So these are the two techniques, the MacLean and Hindle's physiological method. Next we come to the functional reline method. In this technique, what we are going to do, we are going to make an impression. After the mouth preparation, you are going to make an impression, that is an anatomic impression. Even if it is a distal extension case, no problem. Once you make an impression with your regular anatomic impressions, you pour, you make a master cast. And then this master cast is duplicated, and then you form the duplicating cast. Over the duplicating cast, if you see, you apply a metal spacer. You apply a metal spacer like this, and then you are going to make a pattern, and then you are going to make the framework. Once your framework is ready, then you are going to remove this metal spacer from the framework, so that you have space for the functional relining method. Now, with the framework, what you're going to do, you will be adding the low fusing compound on the impression surface of the partial denture, and then you're going to do water molding and make impressions. So with this, once we have tempered and made a proper water molded recorded the tissues, what you're going to do after this, you're going to scrape off 1 millimeter of the low fusing compound, and then you're going to add free flowing impression paste, or you can use your silicone impression, and then make a final impressions. And this entire thing has to be done when the patient is half open. Like, you have to ask the patient to open the jaw, not in a closed or in a biting pressure. You will not do, you're going to make an impression with half closed mouth. The advantages of this technique is fit of the denture on the edentulous ridge is superior. The amount of soft tissue displacement is controlled by the amount of relief given. And drawbacks are, as this is an open mouth impression technique, it is difficult to maintain a correct relationship between the framework and the abutment teeth. And it is difficult to maintain a correct occlusal contact during the relining. Next, we come to the fluid wax technique. In a fluid wax technique, you have special waxes, and these special waxes are applied on the cast framework, that is the impression surface of the cast framework, and in between that, and these special waxes are actually rigid at room temperature, but they have the ability to flow at the mouth temperature. So you have, for example, you have Iowa wax by Dr. Smith, you have the Corrupta wax by Applegates. So the purpose of it, this technique is to obtain maximum possible extension of the peripheral borders and to record the stress bearing areas in the functional form. How do you do it? You have a framework, you have the impression surface. What you are going to do, you apply the molten these fluid wax onto the impression surface with the help of the brush, and after that you are going to record it. You're going to place it back into the patient's mouth and record in a functional form by making those movements, and allow it to remain there undisturbed for 5 to 7 minutes, and then you're going to repeat the same procedure so that you can do a proper border molding, and also you directly make impression with this these waxes. Another thing, with the final increment, when you are placing, you have to wait for at least 12 minutes. And once you are done, then this is ready to be port for your danger base. Another thing which we need to keep in mind is whenever you're doing your border molding with this type of wax, when you have a positive tissue contact, the wax will appear glossy. And if it does not have contact with the tissues, then they will appear dull. So the advantages are they produce an accurate impression if the steps are properly followed. The drawbacks are the procedure is time consuming and technique sensitive. Everybody cannot do it. They should be trained with this. And proper time period is required for. Another drawback for this impression is you need a proper time period during impression procedure to follow. Otherwise, your impression, there will be excess of tissue displacement. Another thing is, since the wax distort, if you keep this impression for a long time, that is the reason you should be pouring this impression as soon as possible so as to minimize distortion of the impression. Next impression technique is the selective pressure technique. This technique is based on the concept of loading the stress bearing areas and adequately relieving the non-stress bearing areas. By doing this, what we are going to do, we are applying greater functional stress on the stress bearing areas and we apply less stress on the non-functioning or non-stress bearing areas. Like for example, the crest of the ridge in the lower ridge will be a non-stress bearing area and your buccal shelf region is your stress bearing area. So you will apply, you're going to relieve this non-stress bearing area by giving a spacer there. And in the buccal shelf region, there will be a direct contact of the your custom tray with the tissues. So you'll be applying more stress in that region. Likewise, in the maxillary arch also, you're going to relieve the non-stress bearing areas like the mid-palatal region, your PPS region, and your crest of the alveolar ridge, and you're going to be applying more stress on these stress bearing areas like the rugae region, the palatal region, the buccal and lingual slopes of the residual ridge. So in these stress bearing areas, we are going to apply more stress and we are going to provide relief in the area so that we don't displace the tissues there. So as I told you, in the lower arch, buccal shelf region is the primary stress bearing area and the slopes of the ridge are in the maxillary arch. The advantages of this technique is that it provides a closely fitting denture base and the tissues are selectively loaded depending on the stress bearing capacity. The drawbacks are it is difficult to accurately demarcate and relieve the stress bearing and non-stress bearing areas. You could find areas which could be either stress bearing or non-stress bearing. So it is very difficult to demarcate that, and that is the drawback of this technique. So finally, we come to the end of impression techniques in removal partial dentures. Thank you for watching the video.